down. We really had a good time. It's beautiful.
Christmas music.
Where did you put the music?
You talking about the box?
Yeah, right there. Yeah, right there. I'm sorry. I thought Steve was so excited he's coming up sing solo. We're glad to have you. Beautiful Christmas music. We figure if Walmart can start Christmas, we can too. So that's why we started, and I appreciate Dwight so much. The Change Collection looked like it went real, real well. You know, Sheila has a birthday tomorrow, so let's just bombard her and let her know how much we appreciate all the hard work that she does. She is down here at least once a week. We've given her her own office, and she works on that year round. In fact, the first Sunday in January last year, she said, "Now, we need to get together about Operation Christmas Child." I said, "Sheila, that's 11 months off." She said, "I think about it every day of the year." So we appreciate her so much. You might have misunderstood me this morning when I talked about the Golden Mission offering. The money that we get back from the state doesn't go to our church, it goes to our association. You might have gotten it all excited when I talked about the $10,000 coming back to our church. It comes to the Haywood Association. But, you know, we pool that and we've got some ideas on how to spend it. But that is a really good investment. We take up the offering, we send it to Brentwood. They, in turn, send some back to us. It is proportional to the number of church members, the number of churches. Obviously, Shelby County gets more than Haywood County, but we do get way more than our share. So thank you for your participation on that. I think that our inreach is off to a good start. The best way to do that is through Sunday school. Every class has prospects. If they came once, you got a real good chance of getting them to come back again. Even if we get one-third of our inactives to come back, we're talking about 75 to 80 in Sunday school and 100 for worship. I mean, we will really get back to where we have been in the past. So let's work hard and claim this month as a blessing to God and our community. Had a real good response to Trunk or Treat. We will have a sign-up sheet on the bulletin board tomorrow for you to volunteer your car. We want you to bring your car, pop the trunk, or raise the lid, decorate it with some fall theme, nothing scary. We don't want any headless horsemen or anything like that. And we're going to give out candy plus Bibles, plus information about the church, plus hot dogs. Can't have a community outreach without good old hot dogs, so that's our plan. We also, let me just remind you one last time, we've got some openings for the trip. If you're going, we're leaving at 8. Don't come at 5 after. You know, we really try to be punctual. I know some of y'all will be here at 4 o'clock in the morning. But 8 o'clock is when we leave. We've got some openings. If you'd like to know to go, you let me know, okay? Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, it's been a great day in your house. We're really grateful for the way your spirit moved this morning. I personally felt like it was a great time of worship. It's wonderful congregational music and a beautiful solo by Liz. And Father, it's exciting to get back in the choir and to lift up our voice in praise. Music is such an integral part of our ministry, and we've been noted over the years for having a really, really good music program. And I'm glad that we're resurrecting that, and I pray that even tonight we would worship you with a reckless abandon, not worried about what anybody thinks. The only approval we seek tonight is yours. And we commit this service to you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, first of all, I want to promise everybody that I will finish choir at least 5 minutes before it's service time, because I was starting to get hyped there at the end. It was sounding good, so I feel like you guys done a great job tonight. Even if the preacher was saying, "Oh, there he is, sorry."
Yeah, I know.
Get a drink of water.
Yes. So I tell you what, let's sing hymn 135, the first verse, and we'll stand. That's our opening hymn, and we'll sit down, and I'll talk some more, and then we'll go on some more. So let's stand and sing one verse of Nothing But the Blood. She's cremated, she's in a box, and she'll be, her memorial service will be next Saturday. And the reason it took so long is because her husband gave me a gift that kind of kept on giving. He gave me COVID that he picked up at the hospital, and I think that's how I got it, if I didn't get it at Walmart, that is. See how people go to Walmart and not get something anyway. So most of that stuff is gone. I had a sinus congestion. I still have a little of that, but I'm feeling better. Pray for me too. See, also I have a CAT scan. By the way, you know why they don't let dogs do MRIs, don't you? Because CAT scan.
CAT scan.
CAT
scan. That's bad. Yes, I know. But I've had one before many years ago. Really? It's a piece of cake. I don't mind being shoved in the tube and listen to that. Sounds like drums warming up to me. So it's relaxing. Puts me right to sleep. All right. Let's do the rest of our hymns now. Fairest Lord Jesus. And follow that with I Love Thee. And then I Love You, Lord. And then it'll be Brother Greg's time. Go ahead.
Yeah.
I love the last the last line that song, "How much I love thee, my actions will show." Talk about that in Sunday school this morning, didn't we? You know, God demonstrated his love to us, and we respond by loving other people. I want you to take your Bible, turn, if you will, to 1 Corinthians chapter 12. Just going to read this as a launching pad. We looked at it last Sunday, but I do want to remind you of what Paul writes here. 1 Corinthians 12, and I'm going to read verses 1 through 11 as we continue talking about spiritual gifts. You have a spiritual gift. It is not the same thing as a talent. Everybody has a talent. A spiritual gift is something given by the Holy Spirit, a special attribute given at the point of your conversion to be used in service to Jesus through the context of the local church. You cannot use a spiritual gift apart from the church. It has got to be used within our church family. That is the definition. We're going to talk tonight about perhaps having how to discern your spiritual gift. And then we're going to talk about the various gifts that are mentioned in Scripture. 1 Corinthians 12. "Now, dear brothers and sisters, regarding your question about the special abilities the Spirit gives us," he's answering the question that they had written to him. And the problem was, you had people who came in and they thought that their gifts were more important than other people's gifts. You even had people who came in and said, "Look at me! I can lay hands on people and heal them. I can speak in tongues." Now, maybe or maybe not, but they wrote Paul. They said, "Paul, we've got some issues." That's what 1 and 2 Corinthians are. They write Paul a letter, he responds. They write him another letter, he responds. They write him a third letter, and they sort of complain to him and say, "Paul, you've let us down. You said you were going to come visit us, and you haven't, and we're disappointed in you." And he doesn't respond to that. Good lesson. When somebody writes something critical to you, throw it away. Wad it up, toss it in the trash can. Somebody sends you an ugly text, an ugly email, ignore it. That's what Paul did in this third letter they wrote to him, complaining and attacking him. So, okay, he answers the question. "You know that when you were still pagans, you were led astray and swept along in worshiping speechless idols. So I want you to know that no one speaking by the Spirit of God will curse Jesus. And no one can say Jesus is Lord except the Holy Spirit." Now, the Spirit lives within us, and he gives us the ability to say it. But you cannot say it without his empowering Spirit. "There are different kinds of spiritual gifts, but the same Spirit is the source of them all. There are different kinds of service, but we serve the same Lord. God works in different ways, but it's the same God who does the work in all of us. A spiritual gift is given to each of us so we can help each other. To one person, the Spirit gives the ability to give wise advice. To another, the same Spirit gives a message of special knowledge. The same Spirit gives great faith to another, and to someone else, the one Spirit gives the gift of healing. He gives one person the power to perform miracles, and another the ability to prophesy. He gives someone else the ability to discern whether a message is from the Spirit of God or from another spirit. Still another person is given the ability to speak in unknown languages, while another is given the ability to interpret what is being said. It is the one and only Spirit who distributes all these gifts. He alone decides which gift each person should have." And Heavenly Father, I pray that each of us would come a big step and make great progress tonight in discovering what our gift is. Help us, Heavenly Father, to really pray upon it, and not just to go out and pick something, harum scarum, but to really follow your leadership. We know you are a self-revealing God. There may be somebody here tonight who says, there's nothing I can do. And Lord, when people say that, they're making you a liar. You do not lie. Everything you speak is truth, and it is true that each of us have a gift. And the greatest thing we can do is use it for your glory through the church family known as Papa Corner Baptist Church. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, I'm going to pass these out, but don't look at them yet. Don't look at them. We're going to do some case studies, some scenarios. I'm going to describe a situation, and I want you to think about how you would respond to these situations. Okay, let's say you're at a party, and somebody spills food all over the carpet. Maybe it's a church fellowship, maybe a Christmas open house, and they trip, and they spill food all over the carpet. Now, what would your response be? Don't say it out loud, but how would you respond? Maybe some of you would say, okay, now you get a broom, you get a mop, you get a vacuum cleaner. And that's a legitimate response. That may mean that your spiritual gift is administration. You see what the problem is and you know how to resolve it. Or maybe you go up and just hug that person and say, oh, I know you're embarrassed, but I want you to know I love you and what you did is no big deal. You're among friends, you're among family. That may mean that you have the gift of mercy. That you just have to reach out and make people feel good after they've embarrassed themselves. Or maybe you just, without being prompted at all, you go to the kitchen, you get a rag, and you start scrubbing. Don't wait on anybody else to do it, you just do it. You grab a dust mop, you grab whatever you need to clean that up without being prompted at all. That may mean that you have the spiritual gift of service. Maybe you might say, well, you know, I've got a full plate. You just dropped yours. Let me give you some of mine. You dropped all of your sausage balls. Let me give you some of my sausage balls. That may mean you have the gift of giving. It is very, very generous. Or maybe you might say, well, let me just go and get you some more. You just sit here, and just lick your wounds. Let me go and get you some more. That may mean that you've got the gift of exhortation. You encourage people by your actions. Well, here's another scenario. Let's say you're driving down the street and you see a homeless person. Somebody holding a sign saying, homeless will work for food. How do you respond to that? Maybe you say, I know that fella is a fake. I know that he's not legitimate. That may mean your spiritual gift is discernment. Discernment means you have a special insight into what's right, what's wrong. I like to have deacons with the gift of discernment. I like to have people on personnel committee, finance committee, who just can smell a rat from a mile away. Or maybe you reach in your pocket and give the fella some change. That may mean you have the gift of giving. Maybe you give him a wad of bills. That may mean you have the gift of giving. I might suggest to you the best thing to do, if you like to give them something, go to McDonald's. McDonald's and get some $5 McDonald's gift cards. Give that to them, or give them a Food Giant gift card. I mean, don't make it for $50, but you know, give them a $5 gift card. You know, they can't afford beer with that. They can't afford cigarettes, but they can go back and get a sandwich and something to drink. Or maybe you roll your windows down and start talking to them about spiritual matters. You say, brother, do you know Jesus is your Savior? Let me just tell you about my best friend is Jesus Christ. That may mean you have the gift of evangelism. You see everybody through the lens of their eternity. Or maybe you say, well, you know, I don't have anything, but I know a church down here that gives away food the first and third Thursday of the month. Or I know a place down here that has a free soup kitchen. If you'll just go down there, I know that they can help you. Yeah, that might mean you have the gift of exhortation. You want to help them out. You don't want to just leave them standing on that street corner. Maybe you just get out of your car and just sit down with that person. I've known people who've done that. The person has an extra seat. They just get out of their car, just sit with them. Kind of like Job's friends did. They came and for a week, they just sat with him and said nothing. When they started speaking, they blew it. But initially, they just showed the gift of mercy. Maybe you get out and you say, you know, can I wash your feet? Can I comb your hair? There was a Bible teacher. I'll tell you who it was, Beth Moore. She's kind of fallen into the deep end. But she was at an airport one time, and she noticed a homeless man over there just, you know, staked to high heaven. She noticed his hair was matted. She went up to him and said, sir, would you mind if I combed your hair? She pulled a comb and a brush and started combing and brushing out his hair. Just an amazing transformation. He started weeping. She said, oh, I didn't do this to embarrass you. And he said, well, ma'am, I didn't tell you, but I'm here to pick up my daughter. Her flight's coming in. I have not seen her in 25 years. And I was ashamed at the way I looked. Now, that is the gift of mercy. Or maybe you drive by and you witness a wreck. Let's think about that scenario. You drive by a wreck that's just happened. Maybe you jump out of your car and you help get the person out, and you tell somebody, now you use your phone, you call 911. You stand out in the street and you flag people away and point them away from this lane. Maybe you have the gift of administration. You get into a tough situation and you know exactly what to do. Or maybe it's in the winter, you just take your coat off and wrap the victim up in a coat to keep the person warm. May mean you got the gift of giving. You may say to that person, hey, that coat is yours. I don't want it back. It's a gift. When I was at school in England, it never was hot there. It was usually about 70 there, which, you know, that's not cold at all. But I had some black brothers who were in school with me, and they just froze to death. They like hot weather. And one day it was about 70, and one of my brothers came up and he said, man, aren't you cold? I said, no, I'm not cold at all. I'm fine. He said, man, it's freezing out here. Well, I went to lunch. I came back. That rascal had gone out and bought me a English fog, is that what it's called?
London
fog. Bought me a London fog jacket. At lunch. He said, I knew you were cold. I bought you. Hey, you're talking $100. Even though I didn't need it, didn't want it, I still was obligated to wear it. It burned up the rest of the week, but that's the gift of giving right there. Or maybe you go up and say, well, now this is why the wreck happened. Car hydroplaned, you didn't have enough tread on your tires, things like that. That may mean that you've got the gift of teaching, instructing why something happened. Maybe just grab a broom, start sweeping up glass. Means you've got the gift of service. So just think about these scenarios and how you'd respond. Okay, let's look at the sheet that I just gave you. These are spiritual gifts that are mentioned in Scripture. There are three places that talk about spiritual gifts. 1 Corinthians 12, 13, and 14, Ephesians 4, and Romans 12. And let me start off with that same proviso I mentioned last week. Billy Graham, I guess, is the first person I ever heard to bring this up. But others have followed along. I know David Jeremiah and Adrian Rogers and others have picked up on this. I think there's a real possibility that this is a representative rather than an exhaustive list. There may be gifts in addition to these. Now, that is a theory that's been proposed a couple of hundred years ago, but you just think about that. You look at that and say, man, I don't fit in anywhere. Let's talk through some of these gifts. Number one, the gift of service. The ability to give assistance or aid in a way that brings strength or encouragement to others. There have been some people who've served you, but they've done it with a chip on their shoulder. You ever gone to a restaurant and the white person comes and slams your water down and slides the food across the table, you know, like you're at a saloon in the Wild West, and just spills it all over you and just acts sullen and angry. Now, technically, that person is serving, but does that bring you encouragement? Does that bring a nice, warm, fuzzy feeling? You serve, that means you meet needs, and you are glad to do it. You don't do it begrudgingly. You don't do it expecting something in return. You just do it. And speaking of white people, I hope if you say the prayer before your meal, you better be a good time. And you better not complain and moan and groan and, you know, cause them all sorts of problems. If they see you pray at the table, even if they are terrible, you leave a good tip. You treat them kindly. You let them know you are a person on mission, representing the Lord Jesus Christ, and you can endure some poor service. So that's just a little tip. That doesn't cost you anything. Okay, the gift of giving. The ability to make and distribute money to further the cause of Christ. Some people just have the ability to make money. Got a golden thumb. And man, there's not a thing in the world wrong with that. Bible spotlights wealthy people. Think about Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus, who donated that empty tomb. Of course, Jesus was only there 3 days, and not as though they had to sell it used next time somebody wanted to use it. Think about Lydia, that wealthy seller of purple who helped start the church at Philippi. Think about the wealthy women who supported Jesus in his ministry. Think about Lazarus and Mary and Martha. They lived in Bethany, which was the Collierville of Jerusalem. That's where all the big wealthy houses were. The Bible spotlights wealth. There's some great men and women of God who just have the ability to make money and give money away. Yeah, and I can cite example after example of people who've just given away so very much. Dwight and I had this friend in Adamsville, Bernard Blassingame, started made plastic boats and things like that. And no telling how much Bernard gave to Union University and gave to the church. And so he just had the Midas touch and made money. There was a fella in Union City, not even a Baptist. He was a Methodist. And Rascal wrote a check for $12 million to build a new library at Union. I wish I could do that. You know, maybe you wish you could do that as well. You know, God's not concerned with that check for $12 million. He is concerned about that check for $50 or that check for $100 or whatever. But you may have the gift of giving. And next, we've got the gift of showing mercy. You work joyfully with people the majority ignore. You don't mind going to the nursing home. You don't mind going to a veterans hospital. You don't mind going to a homeless shelter, etc. I've got an African-American friend who's pastor in Chicago. And he had a deacon in his church who was just, a man in his church who's rough as a cob. He's a deacon now, but I mean, he was rough as a cob. And he got gloriously saved, and he went to my friend J.C. and said, Pastor, I sure would like to do something for the Lord, but I don't know of anything I can do. And in a flash, my pastor said, well, why don't you go down to the veterans hospital and just volunteer there? About a month later, that fellow came back and he said, Pastor, I have found my calling. Those men there, most of them, don't have anybody to cut their toenails. And I just go and I cut toenails all day. And I tell them about Jesus. And man, I can't tell you what, that fella did that for years. Cutting toenails. Now that is the gift of mercy. Well, no, very many of us would be willing to do that. Gift of healing. You know what I mean? Anybody got the gift of healing? I do. I've met some doctors who have the gift of healing. When I say the gift of healing, I'm not talking about spectacular. I'm not talking about healing on national TV. I'm talking there are some people who have been given the ability to bring recovery, spiritually, emotionally, or physically. I believe that I've been to some doctors and nurses and dentists and veterinarians. Well, I haven't been to a veterinarian, but I believe I've been to some medical practitioners who have the gift of healing. You think about, you went into the hospital, Brother Horace and I were talking about it. You know, Brother Horace had a massive heart attack, and they really weren't sure that he was going to recover. And God gave somebody the gift of healing. And I assumed you had a good, godly Christian doctor. I think you mentioned that to me. And God gave him that gift. And, you know, when I fell and had all my injuries in Hawaii, broke 11 bones, I got to the hospital in Maui. Man, I had a godly Christian bone specialist. And she prayed over me, and I believe she had the gift of healing. Okay, moving on. Gift of leadership. Ability to lead others and help manage the affairs of the church. Thank God for the leaders he's provided for us over the years. And they've been visionary, and they've helped us and challenged us and motivated us and kind of got us on track. The gift of faith. You might not think about this, but we are where we are because there were people who stepped out in faith. Kept sorrow, or I don't know who it was. One night, Brownsville Baptist was sitting around kind of dreaming about the future. And somebody said, on Boyd Avenue, that would be a good spot to plant a church. You got a nice neighborhood there. You got a lot of young families. Why don't we pray about that? That's a gift of faith. It's not as though, somebody just, made a motion in business meeting one night. Next thing you know, they were breaking ground. It's a process whereby they stepped out on faith, they invested money, they sent some people over, like Miss Evelyn and others, sent people over to kind of prime the pump, I guess you could say. And that's what got us started. A lot of missionaries have a gift of faith. They can step out and see things that maybe we can't see because we're so focused on reality. Let me move quickly. Apostleship, the ability to start a new work. That kind of goes hand in hand with what I said. Again, missionaries have this ability. We had a fellow from our church in Arkansas went as a missionary. In a year, he'd started 19 churches, and they multiplied. You're talking 1,000 churches now. It wasn't so much that my friend had a lot of charisma or anything like that. He just had faith, and he was an apostle and was able to start new works. Prophecy is the ability to speak for God. Doesn't mean you look at a crystal ball and you can see the future. It simply means God gives you a message and you convey it. Think about when God spoke to Moses, and Moses conveyed that message to Aaron, and Aaron spoke it. That's kind of a maybe an illustration of how that works. When I speak, my prayer is that I'm not speaking my own words, that I'm speaking the words of God. Evangelism, now that doesn't excuse us. We're all called to practice evangelism, but there's some people who just have a better ability to draw the net. You know people like that, and they share the gospel, and people are a lot more likely to respond. Billy Graham is the supreme example. Nobody's going to say Billy Graham's sermons were, theologically rich and, just these beautifully put together. Simple Bible sermons quoting scripture. The Bible says, the Bible says, the Bible says. In fact, there are a lot of these, PhD academics who look down their nose on Billy Graham's preaching. They say, well, he's not sophisticated enough. Well, Jesus wasn't overly sophisticated in the eyes of the scribes and Pharisees, but Billy Graham could draw the net better than anybody I have ever known. Teaching means that you can interpret and explain the Word of God in a way that people understand it. We've got some great teachers here, and I'm grateful for that. Exhortation means you can get people to do things that they don't normally want to do. I've been exhorted into action by people. I've been shamed into doing things by people, things I really didn't want to do. But I did it because people with the gift of exhortation. Discernment of spirits. You are able to discern between truth and error. Satan can wrap up error in a box with a bow and make it so appealing. You've got to be able to know the difference. John says you test the spirits, make sure they're from God. Then the gift of music. Thank God we got some musicians here. They lift us up to the portals of heaven. Let me just real quickly talk about these miracles of the spectacular. And these are always downplayed. And they may have been one-time gifts to be used in furthering the gospel. The gift of miracles. The ability to do something beyond the ordinary. It's not the laws of nature are suspended, and you do things that nobody else can do. You shake a snake off into a fire. You put mud on a blind boy's eyes, and the blind boy is able to find sight. You tell a widow, now, you cook me some hot biscuits. She says, I'm sorry, I'm almost out of flour and Crisco. You said, you make these hot biscuits for me, and you're not going to run out of Crisco. You're not going to run out of buttermilk. You're not going to run out of flour. And that miracle allowed her to feed Elijah and feed her family in Bethlehem. There's no logical explanation for that. That's a gift of miracles. And like I said, it may have been a one-time gift. That has now ceased to be legitimate. And then the gift of tongues. That may have been a one-time ability to speak cross-cultural. When all of these people are sent out on the day of Pentecost, and I mentioned this last week, Philip didn't know how to speak Punjabi when he went to India. Thomas didn't know how to speak whatever they speak in Egypt, I guess Arabic. He didn't know how to speak that. Now, Paul didn't know how to speak Spanish when he headed that way. Nobody knew how to speak English. When they went to England, we've got ample evidence that they went to England pretty quickly. And then interpretations. There may be someone who's able to say, well, this is what that person meant. We played a joke when I was at Union. But there was an Old Testament professor who was a nice fellow named Dr. Jim Jones. Not Kool-Aid Jim Jones, but another Jim Jones. I liked him very, very much, but he was boring. He was boring. In the last day of class, this fellow, Harry Berlew, y'all may know Harry. Harry stood up and he started going, somebody on the other side stood up and said, what Brother Harry just said is thank God this is the last time I have to sit under Dr. Jones the rest of my life. Now, of course, they had prepared it in advance, but it's the only time I've seen tongues and interpretations used in the same service. Okay, how can you discern what your spiritual gift is? Let me give you four quick principles. You might want to jot these down. How can you know your spiritual gift? Number one, experiment. They all start with E. Experiment. Experiment. Try as many things as you possibly can. If we ask you to do some job, I want you to know we've prayed about that. Not as though we just have some names we got to fill in. We prayed about that. If we ask you to do something and it's kind of a stretch, go ahead and do it. We're going to have enough other people on the committee to help you if you stumble, but just experiment. Do as many things as you feel like you can do. Sing in the choir. Maybe you've never sung in the choir before. Go on a mission trip. And I can't tell you what that does for me. It blesses you a whole lot more than it blesses them. Go to a youth activity. You'll love it, I hear, but experiment. Do as much as you can. Number two, examine. Experiment. And I'm sorry, I keep getting out of camera range. I'm sorry. Number two is examine. Examine your feelings. Do you enjoy doing it? Do you like it? Does it bring you satisfaction? If you do something here in the church and you're miserable, you absolutely hate it, that probably means that's not your spiritual gift. You know, every Sunday, you don't want to get up. You say, I just want to lie here. The people there don't like me. I'm just more comfortable at home. Every time I try to do anything, I'm a big flop. The wife says, well, number one, you've got to get up. Number two, you're the teacher. if you hate it, that probably means that you're not gifted in that area. Number three, evaluate. How good are you at it? Let's say you try to teach Sunday school. Within 30 seconds, people are asleep, you know, falling out of their chairs onto the ground. Or let's say you feel like, you know, God's leading me to drive the church bus. First time out, you hop a curb, you take down a couple of signposts, you know, you get a speed ticket. That may mean that, you know, that's not really your thing. Or the first time you try to sing, you know, every dog in the neighborhood starts howling. It may mean that's not your gift. So be honest. You evaluate, am I any good at this? Now let me give you one little note here. First time I preached, I evaluated myself, and according to that evaluation, I'm never going to do it again. It was going to be a first and a last time. But, you know, a couple of people came up and said, well, it wasn't as bad as I thought it would be. So that was all the encouragement I needed. So experiment, examine, evaluate, and fourthly and finally, expect confirmation. Expect confirmation. Somebody will come up to you and say, you did a really, really good job organizing that funeral meeting. You did a very good job teaching that month's worth of Sunday school lessons. You did a very, very good job on that mission trip. You are a breath of fresh air. You encourage people. You motivated them. The trip was much better because you were there. People will confirm it. I promise you. So what are the steps? Number one, experiment. Try as many different things as you possibly can. Number two, examine. What do you enjoy doing? Number three, evaluate. Am I any good at this at all? Number four, expect confirmation. And when all of those line up, then you can pretty well say, this is my spiritual gift. About 200 years ago, The main port in Scotland was a place called Holyhead Bay. It's where all of the ships pulled in. Holyhead Bay was a very, very difficult bay and port to arrive in. Very rocky and shallow and so forth. And what they did, they put four lighthouses starting 4 miles out, 3 miles out, 2 miles out, 1 mile out. And how you did it, when you were way out at sea, you lined up those four lighthouses. If one was askew, then you were not on the correct path. But if all four of them lined up, then you knew you were on the right path and you were not going to hit any rocks and you weren't going to sink. That's what I would suggest to you about these four principles. When they line up, then you can pretty well say, this is my spiritual gift. And let me tell you, the greatest joy in all life is discovering and using your spiritual gift. All right. Well, I appreciate your attention tonight and look forward to seeing you Wednesday night. If I can ever do anything for you, please let me know. I'd be happy as a lark. But you've got to just let me know. Let me say one more thing before we leave. I mentioned earlier. Vicki Emerson's surgery is finally rescheduled. It is Tuesday at Vanderbilt. It's a pretty serious surgery. So you be praying for her. I think today is her husband Mike's birthday, as a matter of fact. So you pray for her. And then just a little personal privilege. I have a real, real good friend who's a deacon over at First Baptist Bollinger. I've been knowing him 40 years. Named Walter Anderson, who is having just critical life-threatening surgery tomorrow at Baptist DeSoto. A kidney of his is just shot. And they're trying to, and he only has one. The one that's left is shot. And they're trying to repair it. And if not, you're talking about renal failure. And, you know, the family has been told it's a real long shot. So please, please remember him. One of the finest deacons, one of the greatest encouragers you'd ever want to know. So Walter Anderson. Somehow his wife Martha Jewell and Janet Lewis are friends. I don't know how, but they're, I don't know if they went to college, to high school together or what, but they're friends for some reason. Okay, let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this time together. We thank you for your word. We thank you for the leadership of your Holy Spirit. I pray that we not wander around in the dark about what our gift is. Help us to discern what it is and deploy it for your service. We know that Satan's a liar. He's going to come along and he's going to say, oh, you don't have anything you can do. You don't have any gifts. You're just as useless as you can be as far as service is concerned. He's a liar. And I pray him, the Father, that his lips would be sewn shut and that the only voice we would hear is the Spirit of God who encourages us and reveals the things of God to us every moment of every day. Bless us as we go from here. Help us, Heavenly Father, to remember that as soon as we pull off this lot, we are entering into a mission field. And I pray that we'd be faithful in serving you wherever you might place us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.